Dear learner, today I am going to discuss about fundamental rights. This is from course 132, unit 5. Now, what is fundamental right? Fundamental rights are basic rights without which no human being can develop their personality. And these rights are mainly for the citizens of a country. There is a little bit difference between rights and fundamental rights. Fundamental rights are mainly for the citizens of a particular country, and these rights are protected by the constitutions, by the judiciary of the country. On the other hand, rights are also necessary, but the rights which are not protected by the constitutions or by the judiciary, those rights are regarded as the simple rights. And in case of India, you know that we Indian citizens, we enjoy certain rights, certain basic rights without which our personality cannot be developed, without which we cannot get whatever for our livelihood are necessary. Now, the preamble of our constitution, when it was adopted, it was mentioned that we, the people of India, have been solemnly resolved to constitute India into a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic, and to give ourselves liberty, equality, justice, fraternity, etc. Now, this liberty, equality, justice, all these things are inserted in part 3 and part 4 of our constitution in the name of fundamental rights and directive principles of state policies. Now, there is again difference between fundamental rights and directive principles of state policies. Fundamental rights are justiciable. It means these are protected by the judiciary, by the Supreme Court of India. Whenever there is any violation of the fundamental rights, we can directly approach to the Supreme Court of India. But in case of directive principles, these are certain instructions to the state governments so that the state should take, or to the government, so that the government should adopt certain measures for the development of the citizens. Time to time, so we find that a number of rights are included in directive principles of state policy, but these are not justiciable. That means whenever there is a violation of these directive principles, no one can approach to the court or judiciary for the resumption of these rights. Now let us see the sources of our fundamental rights. That means where from these rights have borrowed in our constitution. So the framers of our constitutions were especially influenced by the Bill of Rights of American Constitution. Then the declarations of the rights of man in France, the Irish Constitution of 1935, the post-war constitutions of Japan and Burma, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights by the United Nations in 1948. Besides, the contributions of Raja Ram Mohan Roy and Mahatma Gandhi, who launched crusade against untouchability. So you will find that in our fundamental rights, the first right is right to equality. And in right to equality, there is the one clause is there that untouchability has been prohibited from our country, so that there will be no such upper caste, lower caste, big or small and all these things. At the same time, in one clause you will find that it is mentioned that all sorts of titles also abolished except the military personnel. Then what are the nature of our fundamental rights, or the salient features of our fundamental rights? Fundamental rights are natural and legal. These are natural because as soon as we born in India, as soon as a child born in India or becomes the citizen of India, he or she entitles to these rights. So that's why these are the natural laws. These are justiciable. It means that that the court or the highest court of judiciary protects these fundamental rights. So the judiciary is the protector of the fundamental rights. Then these are universal. It means that all citizens, irrespective of their class, caste, sex, community, and religion, enjoy these fundamental rights. These are not absolute. It means that the fundamental rights are not static. These are changeable. That is time to time. You will see that the Constitution of India or the Constitution after amendment deleting some rights or including some rights. So these rights are not static. It is dynamic because it depends on the changing scenario, changing situation, or needs of the people. So these rights are suspendable. Whenever there is the emergency situation, some of the fundamental rights are suspended. Then what are the fundamental rights of Indian citizens? That means, what are the fundamental rights we, the Indian citizens, we enjoy? Part 3 and Article 14 to 35 provides the following rights. The first one is right to equality. Right to equality is inserted from Article 14 to 18. Now, what are this right to equality? Right to equality means everybody is equal before the eyes of the law, irrespective of class, caste, sex, community, or religion. That means for similar kind of guilt, similar kind of crimes, judiciary gives similar kind of punishment. Or similar kind of for a particular post, when you go for applying for a particular post, so if you have the equal qualifications, all of you are entitled to apply for that post. So this is the right to equality. Then in this right itself, this untouchability has been prohibited, then these titles have been prohibited from the Constitution. Then right to freedom. Article 19 to 22 of our Constitution provides this right to freedom, and this freedoms, right to freedom includes six fundamental freedoms, like freedom of speech and expression, freedom to move throughout the country, freedom to take any kind of profession, then freedom to assemble, that means we can gather in one place, freedom to form association. So these are the freedom included in right to freedom. There are six fundamental freedoms. Along with this right to freedom, nowadays we know that right to this education is also included in this right to freedom, as well as right to privacy is also included in this right to freedom. Then right against exploitations, Article 23 to 24, this right against exploitation has been included. And under this, nobody should be exploited. Or person can be exploited by any other person. Right to freedom of religion. As you know that India is a secular country, so each and everybody of us, we can propagate, we can spread, we can promote our own religion, and there is no such restrictions regarding the enjoyment of our religious festivals and so on and so forth. Then cultural and educational rights. This is mainly for the minority communities of the country. So the minorities, as well as each and everybody of our country, they enjoy the right to promote their own culture, to promote their own language. So their linguistic or the cultural promotions, everybody has the equal right. The right to constitutional remedies. So among all these rights, the most important is the right to constitutional remedies, that is inserted in Article 32 to 35. Now, what is this right to constitutional remedies? So on the basis of this right, we can approach to the Supreme Court of India if there is the violation of our fundamental rights. That means if anyone interferes in our fundamental rights, if there is any kind of restrictions in our fundamental rights, then we can approach to the court, and the court, with the help of certain writs like writ of habeas corpus, writ of mandamus, writ of certiorari, writ of quorento, with the help of these writs, the court can protect us and help us to enjoy our fundamental rights or fundamental freedoms. That's why this is the most important right among all these fundamental rights.
So initially in our constitution, right to property was there under Article 31 and as fundamental right, but it was deleted by 44th Constitutional Amendment Act in 1978. In the same way, right to education and right to privacy has been included in the list of fundamental rights under right to freedom. These fundamental rights are not absolute, as we say that. We have previously also said that fundamental rights are not absolute. It means we cannot claim that all the time we will enjoy our fundamental rights. But the fundamental rights can be restricted according to certain situations. So these are known as reasonable restrictions on fundamental rights. Now, the state can put reasonable restrictions on fundamental rights in the interest of sovereignty, integrity and security of India. Now what are the conditions? State can suspend the provision of Article 19, that is the right to freedom of speech and expressions, during emergencies. Whenever there is a national emergency in the country, then our freedom of speech and expression used to be curtailed by the state for the protections, for the security of the country or for the integrity of the country. There is a suspension of other rights during emergencies, like right to move any court. As we know that on the basis of right to constitutional remedies, we can approach to the court whenever there is a violation, whenever there is a restrictions of our fundamental rights. But during emergency, when there is the restrictions regarding the enjoyment of our freedom of speech and expressions, we cannot move to the court because this is also suspended. That is, we cannot approach to the court. Then restrictions on assembly or holding public gathering during emergencies. Whenever there is an emergency situation or whenever there is this 144 order is instituted by the district administrator, then also we cannot assemble. More than four people cannot assemble in one place. We cannot hold any meeting or any demonstration. Then what conclusion we can draw from this? So, the Constitution of India has provided fundamental rights for the citizens of India, basically for the development of the personality of the people of the country. And this fundamental rights has been declared as the basic structure of the Constitution. And basic structure of the Constitution cannot be amended. And it was decided or declared by the Supreme Court of India in 1973 in Keshavananda Bharati case, which was Keshavananda Bharati versus State of Kerala case. The Supreme Court declared that this is the basic structure of the Constitution. But we know that right to property was deleted in 1978 by the 44th Constitutional Amendment. So we find that whatever the Supreme Court decided in Keshavananda Bharati case, it was not exactly followed. Then in the Minerva Mill case and in Goloknath case also, we find that there are so many other decisions given by the Supreme Court of India time to time regarding the this fundamental rights as the basic structure of the Constitution. But we can just say that though we have these fundamental rights and these are not absolute, these are not static, as a result, time to time we find that with the help of the constitutional amendments, certain new rights also included in the as a form of fundamental rights. As we know that nowadays this right to education becomes fundamental rights, as every children has the right to get free and compulsory primary educations. So Supreme Court of India acts as the protector of these rights with the help of various devices which are known as writs, that is the writ of habeas corpus, writ of mandamus, writ of quarantio or writ of certiorari. So here I can end today's discussion, and I hope that you follow this fundamental rights and you understand the basic concept of fundamental rights. Then what are our main fundamental rights, what are the restrictions, or why the constitution provides certain restrictions also regarding the enjoyment of fundamental rights. That's all for today. Thank you.